Hi, I'm Jesse Fink.
And I'm Luis Navia.
We're the authors of Pure Narco, out now through Roman and Littlefield.
And you're listening to Play That Rock and Roll.
And Luis, I want to run two names by you and see what your insight is. One Jesse mentioned is Pablo Escobar. In the book, you mentioned you had a very brief encounter with him. And Escobar's reputation now is that of some great villain of the 80s. And it reeks to me a little bit almost like myth-making. You know, Jesse knows a little bit about myth-making with the book about Bon Scott and how that can get out of hand. So my question to you, Luis, is what was Pablo Escobar's reputation to guys like you in the industry at the time he was alive?
Okay. Number one, the Medellín cartel was alive and powerful before Pablo Escobar. There were figures in the Medellín cartel that nobody even hears about, like Manuel Garcés, José Pepe Sarmiento Cabrera, you know, El Viejo Pepe, which I worked with. He supplied Poli. Poli supplied us. We worked with El Viejo. He was huge, huge. Pablo just became Pablo because, you know, he worked into that and he assumed the role of being the foe of the government. The Ochoa brothers stayed back. He had two very strategic alliances with the Moncada brothers and the Galeano brothers, who later he killed in prison. He invited them to the Catedral, his own private prison, and he killed them. But Pablo assumed the role of, you know, being the face of the war against extradition in Colombia. But the true moneymakers in that organization were like Pablo Correa, who I worked with, made huge amounts of money for the Medellín cartel, the Galeano brothers, and Fernando Galeano. And so the Medellín cartel was not only Pablo, but Pablo is the face of the Medellín cartel. But more money than Pablo, for example, the Galeanos were making much more, and then he killed them. And Fernando I knew personally, and I worked with him, and that's where we, you know, the Coke machine, that was all his merchandise. Yeah. So, you know, people think the Medellín cartel, Pablo. No, the Medellín cartel existed before Pablo. Pablo just took on the face, and especially the face of violence. Yeah. And people were working left and right. Cali was working. But Pablo is, an amazing human being, a tremendous figure in history. You know, you meet Pablo and you realize he's something special. People like that, you know, are obviously something special. Just like most of these guys, all these guys are alpha predators. You can't bullshit them. Believe me, they have a sixth sense that that's an amazing thing about these guys. They just have that sense of smell, alpha predator. And they, I have nothing, you know, like I said, I've seen, they're all volatile. Pablo was not volatile. Pablo was very even. A lot of the guys that I dealt with on a business level were, you know, level-headed people like Rasguño, Pablo, El Negro Galeano, Pablo Correa. They weren't vicious. Well, Pablo got a little off the wall there. But the Medellín cartel was alive and well and doing very well before Pablo.
Yeah.
And he just made it what it is. And the memory of the Medellín cartel is Pablo Escobar.
Yeah.
But there were a lot of elements in the Medellín cartel before Pablo Escobar, and a lot of elements that made it possible for Pablo to be Pablo. His backup, it was, you know, like his cousin. His biggest loss was losing his cousin, Gustavo. His cousin was the brains of the whole organization. And the Ochoa brothers. Mm. Were total brains of the whole organization also. And they handle a lot of the distribution, but then it just became that distribution just, you know, the America wanted so much coke that anybody could go out and distribute. I mean, it was a very welcomed commodity.
But
the Medellín cartel, there's a lot more to it than just Pablo Escobar.
You know, I think Hollywood is still very much, you know, focused on Medellín and sort of telling the Escobar story ad nauseum over and over and over. You know, what I discovered, I guess, writing this book was, you know, that there is a rich vein of narco personalities in Colombia and Mexico that we've never heard of. You know, that could supply storylines for narcos for the next 50 fucking years, you know. And Lewis, over the course of 25 years, sort of encountered most of them.
Yeah.
And somehow miraculously managed to survive. And one thing we haven't really sort of said in this whole discussion is, you know, Lewis actually never carried a firearm, you know. Over 25 years, he never had a gun. There was no sort of blazing shootouts, you know, that he was involved in. You know, the people that he was involved with certainly knew how to use a gun and were quite prepared to use it, but he never once carried a weapon. You're listening to Pure Narco FM with Joseph K.